Welcome to this MetroTrade Connect Tech Talk session today. We'll be looking at the evolution of space on board. By that, I mean looking at some of the technology and the sort of latest build techniques that are transforming the functionality of boats and how we use them. Joining me today on the panel, we have David Cipriani of Centro Stile Yacht Design in Italy. We have Paolo Bertetti, the Vice President of R&D at San Lorenzo. And we have Naval Architect Bill Prince joining us as well from the US. Welcome, guys. First off, with you, Paolo. We're hearing a lot about changing consumer trends. How I want to drill down on how that's impacting boat design and try and pick out some of the trends that we can see which emerging, you know, in boats of tomorrow. Paolo, can you tell me a little bit about your experience in the R&D department at San Lorenzo, what you're working on now, what you're picking up for the consumer?
So let's say in San Lorenzo R&D, basically we are acting as transversal resources. You know that we have the three brand basically, or three division. We have Blue Game, that is a really small boat, sporty boat. Then we have the yacht division, that is fiberglass from 76 feet up to 120, 26 fiberglass. And then we have the super yacht division, that is starting from 44 feet up to 64 meters. So basically, there is a quite big spread of size and issues. So I really can't see or can't recognize only one trend. Depending on the size we are talking about, there are different modes. Let's say I joined anyway the business in the year 2000. Before that, I was working for the automotive. So I can have, let's say, 20 years of history where I have seen how the product had progressed. So in really few words, I can say when I started the job, one of the main issues was speed. So there was not a big issue on volume, not a big issue on external functionality, but was speed. Even for flybridge, so not really racing boat or fast boat. The speed touching 30 knots was a must. Then after that, I've seen moving a bit more in a different direction. It was volume inside, and then light, how to bring the light inside. It was a really a strong request or a strong direction. After that, we have seen moving the people, let's say the clients, in the direction of request for more comfort and more sea keeping. And after that, so year by year, now we are in a different direction. We are in a different reality. That means speed is not anymore an issue, absolutely. And this is affecting the hull shape. And as you can imagine, the hull shape is even affecting then the volume we have inside. But it's not only that. Now the effort or the request is for more space outside. Technically speaking, we are talking about space either for toys or beach club. So this is today, but as R&D, I'm really more focused now on what is coming next. And what is coming next basically is some sort of refinement of the solution that we have used so far to increase the space on the beach club. But on top of that, we have to think what will be necessary in terms of sustainability, because sustainability is becoming day after day, month after month, a much more important issue. For sure, that will have effect on the layout, that will have an effect on how the boat is built and what we can bring on top of that. Because take in mind, whatever we have seen or we have done starting from the year 2000 has, generally speaking, brought additional weight. Nothing was free of charge. And additional weight, unfortunately, has to do a lot with the consumption and consequently with the greenhouse gas and consequently with the environment. Now the environment is bringing the priority, or that will be the solution, let's say, in 2-3 years from now. And consequently, we have to rethink what will be the, let's say, the content of the boat in terms of shape, in terms of volume, in terms of everything, in order to be prepared to give good answers to this question. Even because, don't forget that it will not be anymore the client only to define what we have to do. We have seen now IMO or the European community, all of them are pushing very hard on very aggressive rules to reduce pollution. So it will not be anymore only the clients or the yard or the architect. It will be much more what the rules that are coming will define, and then we will have to give or to prepare good answer for that.
Bill, Paolo talks about the impact of the volume inside, the hull shapes and all that. Can you tell me a little bit about your experience and what the trends you're seeing from the technological side of things, and obviously the advancement in certain composite materials and things that are allowing you to do things differently?
Sure. The first two things that really jump out in that regard are the proliferation of zero-speed stabilization and the diesel hybrid electric propulsion, as well as pod propulsion, because now our restrictions on the location and size of the engine room have really been thrown out the window. With pod propulsion, we can get rid of a midships engine room. If we have hybrid diesel-electric propulsion, the power source doesn't need to be in the same vicinity as the propulsion drive unit itself. So we can really maximize the space available within the hull without the limitations that we used to have, which were fundamental to having a traditional inboard driveline.
David, can I just talk to you a second and just get your take on this, because obviously you're dealing with, Paolo, a big size range of craft. Can you give your input?
I completely agree with Paolo, because it's the real focus. I don't want to repeat the same words in terms of what happens in the past, because in my opinion, now we are in the real moment where the trends are completely changed in the last 10 years. The real answer is what the shipbuilders are doing. It's very different compared to the past. We lost completely the traditional yacht. If you understand what we are talking about for traditional, because we are trying in terms of design, especially to reach another level of living inside of the boat. The market, the global demand is quite unifying, because the common demand is having more space inside and outside. It's not important to have the speed, for sure. That is what really changed the rules of everything. The same thing is for the stability, and in terms of perception of feeling on board is very, very important now. And this is, for me, the real common demand of every side of the boat. But at the same time, I think that is the most difficult question to answer that.
I sense when you look at boat design now, we're entering a sort of very interesting age period here. There was a time when boats would, to some extent, certainly at the production side, would follow a certain format. You'd have your certain, you know, the layouts inside would be very much of a norm. I sense that, I mean, thinking about Blue Game, thinking about the SD118, I think the asymmetric boat, I'm thinking that designers are getting much more playful with the designs, or thinking much more about how their users might actually use that space inside. So it's not carved up as it would normally be. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Volume is not the answer. Volume is okay, but then is how to use the volume. As you have mentioned, if you see to the Blue Game 70, we tried really to reshuffle how the volume is used. And if you look to the 44 meters alloy, again, that is a different way of using the space. It's really a jump in the future. So it's like for architecture. You have seen in the years, starting from conventional flats, conventional house, to the concept of loft, or to the concept of totally different way of using the space. That is important, and that is giving the opportunity to diversify from what we have done years ago. So it's really a challenge to reinvent the way of using the space. And for doing that, let me say that we have had quite a good idea in the past. Mr. Perotti has a quite good idea in the past. He was involving what we call the Archistar. So big architect coming from outside, from a totally different world. So not linked to what has been done for years and years in the yachting. That has brought really fresh air and, let me say, even quite a big challenge from the engineering point of view, because, you know, when you start to say, I like to have a stair that is totally glass, or I like to have a very asymmetrical boat that is giving a lot of flexibility in the layout, but then is having a lot of implication on the structure of what you are used to build with the weight that is not symmetrical. Mm-hmm. Really, that is the challenge, but is a way to diversify, is a way to bring fresh air, is a way to stimulate the clients to invent on the base of what we can do new.
Bill, can you tell me, I mean, just picking up on Paolo there, talking about the challenges of bringing all this new thoughts and concepts into actually putting it, making a boat work with them. One of the things, I mean, we've seen in the past is flybridges getting bigger and bigger with the use of more and more carbon fiber and sort of materials like that. How is technology, how is that composite sort of technology helping designers?
Well, you know, we continue to see a trickle-down effect of features that were previously found on larger vessels finding their way into smaller boats. I want to say something about the idea of bringing an inexperienced designer from a different industry into naval architecture. There are two sides to that coin, and there has to be a backstop of experienced marine engineering to temper some of the designs that may be unseaworthy or downright dangerous or just not in the best interest of the boat, the owner, and the resale value. So when we see product designers, industrial designers come into the industry and try and reinvent the wheel, sometimes their wheel is elliptical or square or triangular, and we need to round the corners of that wheel. It's always nice to see fresh ideas from different sources, but it has to be tempered with real engineering and real naval architecture.
I think we all agree, and Paolo mentioned the seaworthiness is increasingly important. It's because I think one of these trends, one of the consumer trends, is that people are using their boats in a different way, boats of all sizes, staying on the big boats for longer, getting out on the small boats with more people and all that sort of thing. So can I bring you in, David?
From my point of view, the technical progress has made possible the construction of the boat before today was not possible to build. Okay, now we are in different modality. Referring in particular at the stability system, for example, or the use careful use of high-level, high-performance materials as carbon, aluminium, special glass, etc. I think there's a lot of things of feature to make possible what in the past was impossible. For example, the volume is the real target now. At every measurement, in every side, there's this demand of volume. And for example, the stabilization changed the rules. For example, Paolo can confirm, but the new trend of explorer boat are in terms of height, we are talking about the really unproportional boat, and the navigation will be ever more difficult for that kind of boat. And I think we are in a different situation now. These systems could change a little bit the perception, the seakeeping, etc. The other things is the mechanism, the cinematics of mechanism, because now we are full of we are in the same condition. From design point of view, it's very fashion the feature inside of the boat. Okay. A lot of boats use these cinematics or these features to create interest in the boat, and at the same time to extend the space inside or convert the space inside. I think this is that happens in that sense in terms of technology to production.
We talked about, Paolo, you talked about at the start some of the developments with stern, you know, the beach clubs, developments in this around the stern. We've also seen the bow areas of boats being worked on and being evolved and making much more of a feature. Where are the sort of next hot spots, do you think? Is it going to be more involvement of those areas, or do you think there's areas of the boat that need looking at or transforming?
Let me say, the architect will forgive me, but the new key area will be the engine room. Yeah. And then, depending on the engine room, we will see what to do next. Why I'm saying that? For two reasons. Now we see, for the next years, the possibility of introduction of pod in a slice of the market that was never interested in that. So pod were quite popular, let's say up to 70 feet, and then on big super yacht, 80 meter, 90 meters. Now we see starting from 70 feet up to, let's say, 130 feet fiberglass, really the possibility of using pods with what we have already today, that means 3-4 engines in parallel, or what will come that will bring the number of engines in parallel down, but anyway will still give the opportunity to shorten the engine room and to have a lower level of the engine room. So both of these two issues will, in my view, in our view, bring quite the disruptive effect on what we have around. So we are working on that. I cannot obviously tell you what we are doing, but anyway, that is an area where something is going to happen. And then there is another effect that it may maybe can be in the other side, in the negative side. And I'm talking about the additional space that we will be obliged to have in the engine room due to what is coming, let's say January 2021, that is basically the SCR. That is a really bulky box that is taking away a lot of space, is making much more difficult the cooling of the engine room. And then on top of that, we will have to add additional tank. So let's say from one side with the pod, we are going to have space available in areas where it was not available before, but we have to understand how much of this space will be lost due to what we have to add. So it's still a bit foggy situation, but in my view, that will be the next direction, because on the bow, on the beach area, on the fly bridge, I think that we have had already a lot of innovation. We have done whatever was possible. Today, the focus will be the engine room. And then maybe in 5-10 years time from now, another revolution can come when we will have a really, let's say, electric system and hybrid, but to a stage where we are not today. So much more sophisticated, because in that case, probably we will bring an additional contribution to the freedom of the architect. And as was already mentioned by someone before, that will give the possibility to bring the engines, or what will be the next, maybe fuel cell or what else, in different areas of the boat. And this will create a degree of freedom that today we do not have.
Interesting. I've got to bring you in, Bill, on this. What's your view?
I think Paolo is exactly right. The traditional engine room, as we know it, is going to become less and less common down two different paths. One is the advent of, as Paolo said, larger and larger pods, but not only the pod propulsive unit, but imagine, for example, Volvo Penta purchased 7 marine outboards a few years ago, and then they proceeded to recently end production of 7 marine outboards. Volvo Penta, in my view, wasn't interested in the outboard market. They want the technology, as I'm estimating, to create diesel-powered pod units, for example, for larger and larger boats. So we talk about trickle down from super yachts into smaller vessels. I see there's also a trickle up in the advent of larger and larger outboard engines or outboard mounted power pods. Diesel outboards are in their infancy in this market. So that story is just beginning to be written. But eventually, I think we'll have external diesel pods. Now, 10 or 20 years ago, it was unheard of to see a 40 or 50 foot outboard powered boat. And now they're everywhere. And we're just seeing the infancy of the diesel propulsion in that regard. So we may have 100 foot, 120 foot, 30 meter vessels with essentially no conventional engine room, but propulsion packages that are mounted externally like an outboard powered boat. Along the second path, as Paolo mentioned, the next generation of diesel electric hybrid propulsion, or whatever we come up with, will continue to free us from the limitations of having the main engine in the middle of the boat. We can put components in the bow, we can put components, as long as we account for their weight, their mass, in lower value real estate areas in the hull, in the vessel. So I think what these two parallel paths are going to mean is that the traditional midships engine room is going to be less and less common in recreational vessels.
Fascinating to think that. David, what's your view? Is it trickle up, trickle down, super yacht? What's your take?
It's difficult to predict a trend, especially if you are thinking about the market demand. I think the real focus will be the possibility about the customer to select, to choose what is his interpretation of that space. In my opinion, we have to think about the boat as a empty box where the customer can interpret the space as in the his loft in that sense, because we are used to interpret the space when you are talking about house environment, for example. I think we have to work in terms of flexibility of that and to make the boat empty as possible.
Basically, we have a lot of installed power that is unused. Mm-hmm. At the end, whatever is the client is going maximum speed between 10 and 15 knots, whatever is the hull. Mm-hmm. And you can have really some very short time at 20, 25, 28 knots, but really is a negligible percentage. So when you know that, then the question is, but do we need all this power on board? Or do we need a hull shape that is optimized for going 30 knots when 98% of the time you are going much slower than that? So the first point is to understand that. Then you should start to think, to talk about that with the client. Because can you imagine if instead of having two huge V16, 2,600 horsepower, you have maybe half of that, but is more than sufficient to perform what is the normal speed that they are using. Then you can really reduce the weight, you reduce the space of the engine room, so you increase the accommodation space. Today, that is in the background of the mind of the client. So they are using the boat like that, but no one has showed them the picture. I think we should go in this direction. Maybe we will have to go there for sustainability, because probably someone from IMO will squeeze our neck. Maybe we will do that because we are smart. Maybe we will have to do that because the client are asking for that, but that will be the direction in the future. So more knowledge brings more understanding of what is the right path to reach at the end a more sustainable yachts that are a must, because clients should not be shy about having a boat that is bringing in the air CO2, nitrogen oxide, and what else. They should really be relaxed, having fun, and probably we can bring them there, even considering what is really the power that we need on board.
Bill, do you want to say something?
Yeah, I agree, and it's very insightful information. I think when we talk about the evolving power plants, whether we have sort of an electric hybrid, diesel-electric hybrid power plant, or we have self-contained propulsion units like bigger diesel outboards, having the weight of pod propulsion units or outboard units at the transom really dictates the underwater hull shape. We need a full prismatic hard shine hull shape with lots of buoyancy aft to carry the weight of all the machinery at the transom. That's not conducive to efficient displacement speeds, 10, 12, 14 knots. So we may see a divergence of the two evolving powertrains, where the pod unit propulsion is geared towards higher speed vessels and the diesel electric propulsion, where we can put the pieces wherever we want to put the pieces, is geared towards more of a reasonable displacement or semi-displacement speed range, whatever that speed-to-length ratio is for a given boat, because that allows for a more of a canoe-shaped stern, more of a tapered stern, without the requirement of having to carry all of the weight of the machinery at the transom.
Guys, it's been fantastic talking to you about this. I'm sure we could go on a bit, you know, quite a bit more about it, but we've run out of time. But I really appreciate you guys sharing all your insights and input into this sort of how you think the boats of tomorrow might look. So thank you, Paolo Bertetti, David Gibbiani, and Bill Prince. Thank you, guys.